Cupertino Senior Television Productions, in cooperation with the League of Women Voters of Cupertino-Sunnyvale, is pleased to present an analysis of the measures on the June 2010 ballot.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program by and for seniors, and devoted to exploring the many facets of those better years of our lives. The name of our program is inspired by a quotation from Robert Browning. Grow old along with me, the best is yet to be, the last of life for which the first was made. Now, sit back and enjoy a program made especially to provide seniors with useful information, plus some lighter moments to brighten your day.
Welcome to The Better Part. I'm Susan Huff from the League of Women Voters of Cupertino-Sunnyvale, and I'm here with Elaine Manley to bring you information about the upcoming election on June 8th. Elaine, is there anything special about this election that voters ought to be aware of?
Well, this is the primary election for state legislators and representatives for the U.S. Congress. For those offices, voters will choose from just candidates in their own party. Now, the independent voters who marked declined to state on their ballot will not have candidates for partisan offices, but they can ask for a particular party ballot for the Democratic Party or Republican Party and vote that way.
Now, when's the deadline for registering if you want to vote in this election?
Well, to vote in the Tuesday, June 8th election, you must be registered to vote by Monday, May 24th. Now, the registration deadline is always 15 days before the election.
I hear more and more people are voting by mail these days. So if I'm doing that, when do I have to drop it in the mail to make sure my vote's counted?
Well, if you're not a permanent mail-by-vote voter, you have until June 1st to request a vote-by-mail ballot. The ballot must be received by the Registrar of Voters by the time the polls close on Election Day. So you should probably mail your ballot several days in advance, like, say, Friday before the election. However, you can also drop off your ballot at any polling place in your county on Election Day. And if you send your ballot over with someone else, be sure to mark on the envelope that you've done that so that the people at the polls can actually accept it.
So what are we really going to be looking at on those ballots this time around?
Well, locally, voters in seven different school districts in Santa Clara County will have funding measures on the ballots. Three school districts are asking voters to approve new bonds. We have Los Altos Mountain View, or Mountain View Los Altos Union High School District, is seeking voter approval to issue $41.3 million in bonds. The Los Gatos Union has a $30.9 million bond measure, and the Campbell Union Elementary is asking for approval of a $150 million bond measure. So these school bond measures require 55% approval in order to pass. But we also have three districts, Milpitas Unified, Mount Pleasant Elementary, and Alum Rock Elementary, and they're asking voters to add or renew parcel taxes for the support of schools. And Oak Grove Elementary also wants approval to spend money generated by its existing parcel tax. And the North County Library Authority seeks to continue a parcel tax in order to support library services. So the new parcel taxes and the parcel tax extensions, those require a two-thirds yes vote in order to pass. The Oak Grove spending vote only requires majority approval. Now remember, that's not two-thirds or 55% of all the registered voters. That's two-thirds or 55% of the people that vote on the issue. So in this sort of election where we have very few propositions, there's no presidential candidate, you sometimes see important issues like these decided upon by a very small percentage of the population. So it's really important that people take time to vote in the election. We also have the cities of Santa Clara and San Jose have measures on the ballot, and the Santa Clara voters will be deciding on whether to lease city-owned land for a football stadium. And the San Jose voters are asked to approve an increase in card rooms and card room taxes in the city.
But today we're just going to be concentrating on the statewide proposition.
So before I get into those propositions, I'd like to explain a little bit about our organization to eliminate any possible confusion about our purpose of today's discussion. You know, the League of Women Voters is really two separate organizations. One is the nationwide member organization of women and men, and the other is the Education Fund. And neither group ever supports or opposes political parties or candidates, but the member organization will take positions on public policy issues. And the way it works is members will vote to research an issue. They'll study it, they'll collect the information, they'll discuss it, they'll come to a consensus. And then when a new law is proposed, the League can look at that law and compare it to its position on the measure and decide, yes, we want to support it, or no, we're going to oppose it, or we're going to remain neutral. So our member organization may have taken position on some of the propositions that we're discussing today, but you and I, as representatives of the League today, are actually representing the League of Women Voters Education Fund. So we are not here to tell people how to vote. We are here to give an unbiased explanation of the propositions, including the pros and cons. You know, our purpose is to inform voters. It's to not necessarily influence them on how to vote one way or the other. It's one of those wonderful and yet terrifying things about initiative and referendum that we as the voters are actually responsible for some of the laws that shape our society that we live in. So it's a matter of what type of society would you like to live in? Well, please take a serious effort and take some time to understand the effect of the measures and how they will affect what you're voting on. Then your vote will reflect your principles. So that's what our passion is here at the Education Fund. As part of the League of Women Voters, we really want voters to make conscious choices when they mark their ballots. So now on to the measures themselves. What are we seeing this time around, Susan?
Well, we've got a mix. We have two propositions on election procedures themselves, one on seismic retrofitting, one on electricity supply, and one on auto insurance. Let's take them just as you're going to see them on your ballot. Proposition 13 is a constitutional amendment on seismic retrofitting and property taxes. Now, seismic retrofitting, that's just any work you have done on your property to make it more earthquake resistant. And generally speaking, if you add value to your property value is reassessed just as when it's sold. That reassessment can significantly raise your property taxes. Right now, though, there are two laws governing the tax consequences of having work done on your property to make it safer in an earthquake. Both of them say if you add value to that structure by making earthquake safety modifications, that added value shouldn't trigger a reassessment for property tax purposes, at least not right away. The difference in the law is that the section dealing with unreinforced masonry structures, think brick buildings, says that the new work is exempt from property tax reassessment for 15 years. And the section dealing with other kinds of structures says that the new work is permanently exempt from triggering a reassessment as long as the property isn't sold. So Proposition 13 simplifies things. It consolidates those old sections of law and replaces them with a single new section. And that defines retrofitting for seismic safety. And it says none of it will trigger a reassessment of property tax value. In reality, most county assessors don't reassess when you do a seismic safety modification. For one thing, they don't want to count off 15 years. And for another, they want you to have a seismically safe building. So they'd really rather treat it as a maintenance issue than a new construction issue. The result of that is that although Proposition 13, if it passes, will slightly reduce property tax revenues, there really won't be that big an effect. Elaine, do you know what people are saying about this issue?
Well, the legislature put Proposition 13 on the ballot to simplify the law and to encourage the seismic retrofitting, but it couldn't be done by statute because the proposed changes were already in the Constitution, so they had to send it to the voters. There was no argument filed against Proposition 13. Now, Proposition 14 looks to be a little bit more of a battle. What's going on there?
Proposition 14 is also a constitutional amendment. If it passes, elections for congressional, statewide, and legislative races will change, especially in the primary. Right now, voters only see candidates from their own party on the ballot in the primary election. And there's a perception that because party loyalists are the people most likely to vote in a primary, candidates with views that appeal strongly to their party's base are more likely to win a primary election, even if more centrist candidates might have more appeal in a general election, more likely to win over moderates of the other party and independent voters. Proposition 14 is a response to this perceived polarization of candidates. The people who put it on the ballot are hoping that nonpartisan primaries might result in elected officials who are themselves less partisan. If Proposition 14 passes, voters will have all the candidates on their ballot in the primary election, regardless of the voter's party, regardless of the candidate's party. The candidates may or may not even declare a party preference. The two candidates with the most votes, then, regardless of their party, will go on to the general election. The two candidates in the general election could even be of the same party, and in some of our districts, that might be a likely outcome.
So really, two from the same party. What does that do with the minor parties? I mean, right now, they have the automatic spot on the general election.
Yes, but now most of us don't see those candidates in the primary election. So really, it's just a shift. You'll see a lot more names on the ballot in the primary and then fewer names on the ballot in the general election.
Okay, so then which races does this cover?
This proposition would cover your congressperson, your state assembly person and state senator, the members of the Board of Equalization, and those statewide elected offices like governor, secretary of state, treasurer, attorney general. It does not affect presidential primaries. It doesn't affect the superintendent of public instruction. The superintendent of public instruction, that is already a nonpartisan office. And of course, it won't affect party political offices. There will be some costs at the local level to implement Proposition 14 because it changes the way elections are run. The legislative analyst estimates those costs won't be very large, but our simulations show that some counties might need to buy new election equipment if they can't make those changes on their current equipment. What are people saying about Proposition 14?
Well, the people in favor say that Proposition 14 will help elect more practical office holders who are more open to compromise. Senator Maldonado is the best known proponent, and officials in AARP and the Chamber of Commerce signed ballot arguments for it. People against Proposition 14 say that candidates will be able to hide their party affiliation, so voters may be fooled as to where a candidate really stands. Signing arguments against Prop 14 are officials from firefighter, school, and nursing employee associations, and of course the political parties are not in favor. All right, so now next we come to Proposition 15. What do we know about that one?
Proposition 15 is described as a pilot project for public campaign financing. Right now, state law forbids the use of public funds for political candidates' campaigns. And that law has been formed by a series of initiatives. So the only way to change it is to bring proposed changes to the voters. The legislature cannot make these changes. The ban on public funding is true for all statewide elections and almost all local elections. Campaign finance laws are overseen by the Fair Political Practices Commission and the Secretary of State. The Fair Political Practices Commission is the entity that can fine candidates or donors who break election laws. The Secretary of State is the one who keeps track of who donates money and how much to each political campaign, and you can find out all this information at CalAccess, which is part of the Secretary of State's website. The Secretary of State also monitors lobbyists. Those are the people who try to influence public policy on behalf of their employers or their clients. Lobbyists have to register with the Secretary of State every 2 years, and at that time they pay a $25 fee that covers the cost of record keeping and registration. So Proposition 15 makes two major changes to election law. One, it changes the law to allow public financing of public political campaigns, and two, it sets up one public finance program just for Secretary of State. The pilot program is set to start with the 2014 election and expire in 2019, so it would just cover the 2014 and 2018 elections. But the proposition also gives the legislature the power to extend that program or to expand it to other offices. Pilot program works like this. If Proposition 15 passes, then candidates for Secretary of State who agree to obey strict spending limits and forgo private financing, including their own, and who qualify by collecting several thousand $5 contributions can receive funds from the state to pay for their campaign. There's a base level of funding, and that can be supplemented to match spending by a privately financed opponent up to a point, of course.
Okay, so then do all candidates receive the same amount?
Not necessarily. There's a distinction made between major party candidates, minor party candidates, and independent party candidates. Currently, the major parties are the Republican and Democratic parties, but the definition of major is just based on how well the parties have done in recent elections, so the names of the major parties could change. As far as the differences go, For one thing, candidates who aren't affiliated with any party won't need and won't get funds for a primary election campaign. But if they can come up with 15,000 of those $5 qualifying contributions, they can get equal funding in the general election. Major party candidates need 7,500 qualifying contributions, and the candidates from other parties only need 3,750 to get some funding, or 15,000 qualifying contributions to get full funding. The minimum level of support is higher for major party candidates than for candidates from minor parties. On the other hand, if a minor party candidate gets those 15,000 qualifying contributions, meaning they've got broader support, more money becomes available to them. If they're in the general election, that broadly supported minor party candidate would have the same level of funding as a candidate from a major party. But to get public funding in the general election, any candidate affiliated with a party has to have participated in the public financing program in the primary. And any candidate who participates in the public financing program in the primary and goes on to the general election has to continue to follow the public finance laws.
Okay, so then who pays for all of this?
Proposition 15 raises funds for the campaigns by increasing that licensing fee paid by lobbyists, so it would go from $25 every 2 years to $700 every 2 years. Those qualifying contributions raised by the candidates, those would also become campaign funding money. What are the hot topics in the debate on Proposition 15?
Well, the people signing arguments in favor come from AARP, the California Nurses Association, and California Church Impact. They say that Prop 15 frees politicians from fundraising so they can do their jobs. Signing the arguments against are officials from the California Senior Advocates League, California Manufacturers and Technology Association, and the LA Police Protective League. They say that Proposition 15 is full of loopholes and will not stop the influence of special interest money. So what happens if both Proposition 14 and 15 pass?
Fortunately, they're not really butting heads in principle, because when that happens, if both propositions pass, it's always a messy court case. There is, of course, the potential for some conflict between Proposition 14 and 15 if they both pass. For example, some of the funding formulas in Proposition 15 talk about a partisan primary, and we wouldn't even have a partisan primary anymore if Proposition 14 passes. We don't know exactly how it'll all pay out. But the legislative analyst points out there are actually several ways to reconcile the two. If both of these pass, it can be done through legislative action, through court action. There could even be another ballot measure. Speaking of which, let me steal a few seconds just to say the legislative analyst works for us, for the people of California, and does a fantastic job of trying to make sense of propositions and laws and policies for us. And almost nobody even knows who the legislative analyst is. Mac Taylor and his staff are the unsung heroes of Sacramento.
Absolutely. Very good. So now on to Proposition 16. That's another constitutional amendment, isn't it?
Yes. And like all constitutional amendments, it has to come to the voters for approval. Proposition 16 is on electricity supply. Most of us currently buy electricity from either an investor-owned utility like PG&E or a publicly owned utility like Silicon Valley Power. There are a few customers, mostly very large customers, who contract with the different electricity suppliers, one that's not their local utility. If a public utility wants to supply electricity in a new area, in a larger area, that new area generally has to be annexed. And that annexation, that taking of the area into the realm of the local government, would usually require a vote in the area that's changing its status, the people coming in, but not necessarily a vote in the original area of service. There's also been in recent years something called Community Choice Aggregation, or CCA. And there, the local government doesn't set up its own utility, but it contracts with an energy provider other than the local investor-owned utility to buy electricity for the whole community. There's only one CCA in California so far, but a number of communities have been exploring the option, usually pursuing greener power or cheaper power, or both. Now, when a CCA is set up, the norm in that area changes. So customers would now get their service from the CCA-chosen supplier unless they specifically opt out to stay with their former utility. Creating a CCA can be possible with a vote of the local elected governing board and without direct local voter approval. And if a CCA is set up, the local investor-owned utility is required to cooperate with them. Proposition 16 changes things. Requires a two-thirds vote of the people in order for local government to do certain things if those actions use any public funds. The things they'd need voter approval for include starting up a new publicly owned utility, having an existing publicly owned utility provide service to a new area, or creating a CCA. Some of those things currently do require a vote of the people. Under current law, that would always be a simple majority vote. Now, Proposition 16 does provide for exceptions to that new voting rule if the voters have already approved those proposed changes before the proposition goes into effect, or if the local government is only making changes to the contract for its own internal energy use, or if the changes are solely for the purpose of providing specific renewable energy sources. Now, this clause is generating a lot of argument, because opponents are declaring that Proposition 16 will virtually block municipalities switching to greener power suppliers or becoming a CCA in order to buy energy from a producer with a greater emphasis on renewables. And yet, in the proposed law, there is this exception that says that public funds can be spent without the two-thirds vote if they're solely for the purpose of providing power from renewables. Well, our analysts went over the law and the arguments at some length, and our tentative conclusion is that the proponents are pointing to the exception when they say there's really no problem with green power, and the opponents are looking at where it says solely to provide green power and thinking that phrase can be used to block switching to a supplier that merely provides a higher percentage of power from renewables, but not 100%.
I see. So now, how does Proposition 16 define public funds?
That would be tax revenues, payments from electricity customers, bonds, borrowing, pretty much any money a local government is going to have its hands on.
Okay.
And remember what we learned back in Proposition 15. Public funds can't be used for campaigning. So if local governments dislike Proposition 16, and they do, they can't spend any money saying so.
Interesting.
Who else is for and against 16, Elaine?
Well, officials from the California Taxpayers Association and the Chamber of Commerce signed ballot arguments supporting Proposition 16. And they say that, like other local financial decisions, electricity supply decisions should require a two-thirds vote of the people as a safeguard for taxpayers. Unlike the ones we've talked about so far, this proposition is shaping up to be an expensive campaign with over $28.5 million spent, donated to the Yes campaign by PG&E so far. About $18,000 has been donated to the No campaign by the Utility Reform Network. So signing ballot arguments against, we see officials from AARP, the Sierra Club, and the Consumer Federation of California. And they say that Proposition 16 is about protecting PG&E's for-profit monopoly on electricity. So we've got one last proposition on the ballot. What do we have left?
Proposition 17 on auto insurance. It's specifically on liability insurance, but every auto insurance policy has liability insurance, so let's just say auto insurance. Current law was set by Proposition 103 back in 1988, and it prohibits an insurance company from using your history of coverage when it sets the price of your auto insurance. They can use your history with them, a customer loyalty discount, but they can't use your history of coverage overall. Proposition 17, which has to come to the voters because it changes an initiative that was approved by the voters, would change the law to allow continuous coverage to be a factor in auto insurance pricing. Drivers who've had a gap in coverage of more than 90 days in the past 5 years, or any gap caused by failure to pay a premium, could be charged more than those who don't have such a gap. There'd be an exception if the gap in coverage is due to military service abroad. The dominant factors, though, then, as now, would still have to be driver safety, number of miles driven, and years of driving experience. What are people saying about 17?
Well, this is definitely a glass half empty, glass half full proposition, because the people in favor say that the rates will go down for most people and stay the same for those who haven't maintained coverage, while the people opposed say rates will go up for those that don't qualify for the discount and stay the same for most people. So signing arguments in favor, we see a former director of the California Department of Consumer Affairs, the officials of the California Chamber of Commerce, and the Small Business Action Committee, with money coming from Mercury Insurance, about $5.25 million so far. Signing arguments against, we see officials from Consumer Watchdog, Consumers Union, and Vote Vets, with about $170,000 so far from Consumer Watchdog's advocacy arm, the Campaign for Consumer Rights.
Well, if that's all the propositions, is there anything else we want to make sure people know about?
Well, yes. We'd like people to know that the League of Women Voters has speakers like us available before every statewide election. We make presentations on ballot measures throughout the community, at libraries, at churches of all denominations, senior communities, mobile home parks, group associations, corporations, schools, civics groups, and other organizations. If you'd like to schedule a presentation for our group, please go to our website or send us an email with possible dates and times. Our website address is www.cs.ca.lwvnet.org. That's www.cs as in Cupertino, Sunnyvale, .ca as in California, .lwvnet.org. We will be continuing to make presentations all the way up to Election Day on June 8th. And by the way, our October calendar is already filling up, so please feel free to contact us now if you'd like us to give a presentation on the propositions for the November 2010 election. There are likely to be a lot of propositions in November.
There are. And I'd like to make sure we remind the viewers about the League of Women Voters nonpartisan election information website. Voters can learn about everything on their ballot by visiting www.smartvoter.org. That's smartvoter.org, and typing in their address, they can even find their polling place. Other good places to look for election materials: the Easy Voter Guide, found in libraries and community centers and at www.easyvoter.org. That's easyvoter.org. The Easy Voter Guide is printed in several languages, with even more versions available for download. Now, if people really want to dig into the propositions, they look on Smart Voter for links to more information. The Secretary of State's website, and there's a link to it, that is at www.sos, as in Secretary of State, .ca, as in California, .gov, has all kinds of useful information, including the records of who is giving how much money to which propositions and which candidates. Sometimes the supporters and opponents of record are not the people pouring money into the campaigns. That part of the site, that is the Cal Access part, can make for very interesting reading. And finally, the Santa Clara County Registrar of Voters site, www.sccvote.org, of course, has everything you ever wanted to know about voting in this area. But however you decide, please look at your voting choices, spend a little time understanding them, and then vote your principles. Because we voters are the ones who shape the society we live in, and it's worth doing the job right. Thank you for joining us today. And thank you to The Better Part for making this program possible.